Microsoft kind of business productivity stack or platform for, you know, most part of that 10 years for the duration. For the last kind of 3.5, it's specifically been around BPOS or Business Productivity Online Suite as was, and much more recently Office 365 within the context of the overall kind of Microsoft cloud story, cloud strategy, you know, public, private, hybrid, on-premise. So Mark asked me to talk to you all today around, you know, what is Office 365? So basically start with the basics, give you an idea of where we've come from, what we had originally, where we're at right now, understanding how we position it from Microsoft in the UK out to our customer base. Also understand where some of the limitations are. So, you know, there's absolutely no way that I go out there and I say Microsoft Office 365 is right for every company and every circumstance. So it's kind of helping you all understand where it stops and where additional requirements within customers kind of begin. He also asked me to cover off some of the most common objections that I hear from customers around Office 365, so as you can get a better idea of where that kind of where the story starts to fit. So in the next 30 minutes, we'll talk through, you know, the market landscape, how we see it, what are the investments that we as Microsoft are making in order to help here. The Office 365 SKUs or the product lineup, you know, what products are in what version, and so on and so forth. I don't promise that will be simplistic. In fact, it will probably require a little bit more research on your part afterwards just to get kind of the, just to get the idea as to where what is and how that works, and then just the elevator pitch and what some of the basic scenarios are. So we'll go through the consumer and the business SKUs, we'll go through the pitch and the gotchas. What I won't cover are any detailed technical differences between plans. I will show you where to find the best set of technical information out there on the web today, and the reason why you need to refer to that kind of constantly. There's reasons behind everything. I won't talk about specific plans for education, government. I'll cover those off briefly, but I won't go into any detail. It's also not a non-disclosure presentation, so I won't be talking about things that are upcoming that we haven't yet announced in relation to any licensing or technology changes. That's not what the idea of today is. So if I begin with an overview, really you've got to think about Microsoft Office 365 in the context of Microsoft Office to understand all of the component parts. Typically customers have been used to Office having versions, so Office 2013 being the latest, 2010, 2007, 2003, and with each wave of Office launch there's been an investment from Microsoft not just in Office on the desktop, as we kind of had way back in Office 95 days, but also in complementary servers and services. So anybody who knows SharePoint or you know Exchange knows that there's always been kind of a corresponding, I think SharePoint Exchange a long time ago, SharePoint first iteration 2001, and then 2003, 2007, 2010, there's been kind of a wave of server launches in conjunction with Microsoft Office, and there's been this kind of desktop or documents plus and software locally plus services has been the kind of the overarching value proposition from Office from for quite some time now. Office 365 is particularly different. You know, it doesn't mean it was written in 365 AD to start with. And when you've worked at Microsoft and talked about it as long as I have, you know, the old what happens in a leap year, because obviously it stands for 365 days a year, the what happens in a leap year question comes along. The great news is you just get an extra day free as a customer. You know, we don't turn it off every February 29th. I think the key to Office 365 in as a difference between Office with annual versions after is that it's always up to date, be that services from our data center or Office on the desktop, because you can as a customer buy Office 365 as a legitimate means to acquire Office on the desktop, and not cloud hosted Office as an Office that's installed locally. The fact that it's always up to date And that's one of the key value points that's on there. Just to kind of extend on that a little bit, if people have been, you know, if customers in the past have bought a perpetual license or a box copy or, you know, an open license, perpetual license rights have always been on one PC or Mac at any one time. And if you bought Office Home and Student or Office Home and Business or Office Professional, then you would have different apps or different kind of Word, Excel, PowerPoint and the rest in different versions of Office. They always varied suite by suite. And you know, you had to buy a separate suite if you were a Mac user, for example. Office Mac was different than Office Pro, so if you had a Mac and a PC, you'd have to buy two copies of Office. I think one of the big differences when you look at Office 365, not only does it have the latest productivity services running within Microsoft Data Center, so we have Exchange Online, we have SharePoint Online, and we have Link Online, we also have the addition in some of the SKUs of Office 365 Pro Plus. That's not to be confused with what has been called Office Professional Plus in the past. Pro Plus is the subscription SKU within Office 365. Previously, if anybody's aware of the intricacies of Microsoft licensing, you'll know that there was an Office 365 Professional Plus used to get referred to as shortcut as Pro Plus, just to make it a much quicker way of saying it, slightly different. You can still get Professional Plus, Office 2013 Professional Plus. When I talk about Office 365 Pro Plus, I'm talking about one subscription per user for use on up to five devices, whether that's a PC and you know, a PC or a Mac. The services and the Office clients are always kept up to date. So if I give you an example right now, I'm a licensed user for Microsoft Office 365 with inside Microsoft. I have Office installed on my works machine. I have my own tablet. Surface Pro that I've got Office installed on. I've got Office installed on my home machine and also on another machine that's used kind of in my household. So I've got four installations of Office 365, and that one user subscription license, or that one subscription of Office 365, covers me for usage on up to five devices. If I had a Mac, then the click to run streaming from Office is not actually there for Mac right now, but I could download Office for Mac latest version and install that on a Mac too. So the rights to use Office on up to five devices are it's kind of one of the key selling points of Office 365 and how a customer may choose to acquire Microsoft Office in the future. You know, on top of that, if you look at the services in there, Exchange Online, SharePoint Online and Link Online, again, each Office 365 subscription or user subscription license, that five devices, it covers you for use of or access to our data center services on any of those five devices also per user. So, you know, if you think about CALs in the past, whether you've gone down the user CAL or the device CAL route as a Microsoft Office customer, those user subscription licenses actually supersede the CAL in certain instances. So any of the enterprise plan family products actually supersedes the need for CAL if the user or if the customer wants to keep the server on premise. For example, a user can buy and license the latest Exchange server and run a very nice hybrid deployment with some users staying on premise, some users running in Microsoft data centers. They don't need to purchase the CALs twice. The Exchange user subscription license as part of the enterprise plan family Office 365 products would cover them for that. So if we think about the desktop before I go into kind of some of the services, and we look at Office Pro Plus in relation to Office 365, it's really interesting to know that this is kind of high-end premium Office, whether it's consumer or business. So the professional applications appear in both the consumer and the business SKUs, so Word, Excel, PowerPoint, Outlook, OneNote, Access and Publisher. Two consumer SKUs on the left, Office 365 University and Home Premium, and then three business SKUs that you can see there on the right, Small Business Premium, Mid-Size Business and Enterprise E3. I've labeled that specifically as Enterprise E3 because you can buy Office 365 Enterprise E1. There is no E2. E2 used to be E1 plus Office web apps. Web apps are now included in E1. However, E1 does not contain a desktop copy of Office. There is also an additional SKU at the top end of the Office 365 Enterprise platform, which is E4, that includes Enterprise Voice CAL capabilities, although you need a Link server on premise to enable PBX breakout and so on. So You know, just to give you a gist of on the screen there, which versions contain Office, those are the SKUs that you need to be aware of. And the professional apps are actually in both. Now, there are slight differences between business and consumer. So in the business SKUs, small business, premium, mid-sized business, and E3 also contain the link client. And then in mid-sized business and E3 only, you also get InfoPath. Not too many small businesses out there have a need for kind of web-based form collation automation. So that's only in mid-sized business and the enterprise E3 SKU. There are some technical caps on each of these SKUs as well, and I guess it's probably best to cover them off right now just while it's kind of visually there. Small business premium has a technical cap at 25 users, mid-sized business at 300 users, Office 365 Enterprise E3 has no technical cap as such, but it's been tested up to 50,000 users. So supported in an environment up to 50,000 users. That's not to say that it won't work kind of above that, but that's what we've tested it to right now. So if we look at small business premium, mid-sized business and E3, right now they are separate platforms in separate racks in the data center. There's no migrate between those product families nice and easy. So if you want to go standalone, because you can buy some of the services Exchange Online standalone, that's part of the enterprise family, and you can only ever migrate up in that manner. But hopefully that helps understand which apps are in what. There's also differences between kind of the way in which consumer and business SKUs are licensed. So Home Premium, for example, it's an annual subscription. It covers 5 devices per household and 5 mobile devices, 5 mobile phones, let's be clear about that, per household. And it comes in at $7.99 a month or $79.99 a year. Office 365 University for students is a 4-year subscription, 2 devices and 2 mobiles per user, and that's $59.99 for 4 years. So those consumer products are kind of nicely positioned for lower end of the market, individual users, households. The business SKUs are much more consistent in how they are licensed. It's an annual subscription. It's 5 devices per user plus 2 mobile phones per user. And the prices vary depending on what's in the suite. So if you look at kind of the services that come with the products from a consumer perspective, you get 60 Skype minutes a month. From a business perspective, you get Link Online Plan 2, which is basically instant messaging, presence information, it's peer-to-peer voice calling, conference calling internally, no PBX breakout. As I say, you need the Enterprise Voice Call and Link on-premise to do that, which is contained in E4. And then you have differences between Plan 1 and Plan 2 across the products. So Plan 1, it's not an exact... you can't say it's exactly right, but a very good guideline would be to consider Plan 1 of Exchange and SharePoint as standard equivalents and Plan 2 as enterprise equivalents. So if you're familiar with Exchange Standard, Exchange Enterprise, Plan 1 and Plan 2, it's kind of like the best differentiation guideline I can give you in relation to what's available in the different SKUs of Microsoft. And obviously it's E3 or the enterprise SKUs that contain Exchange Online Plan 2 and SharePoint Online Plan 2 with some of those enterprise capabilities. So the elevator pitch right now is, as I would give this from a Microsoft perspective to kind of SMB customers, not particularly kind of enterprise or corporate customers at this level. But I'd go down with the, you know, Office 365 is a new way to acquire Microsoft Office. It's pay per user per year. It's a subscription basis. You get the rights to use the software or install it on up to 5 devices per user. And then if you so desire, you've also got business grade cloud services if you want to do email, file sharing, collaboration and communication et al. So kind of a nice easy way in which you can position Office 365 to a customer base. So now we've kind of covered off the basics, what's in the SKUs from an Office perspective and what the product families are, small business, premium, mid-sized business and enterprise. And talk a little bit more about the opportunity and where we see this. And this is the old it's one of the oldest things going in relation to technology adoption. It's known as Rogers Bell Curve. It's from a book by Joanne Boland, George M. Beale, and Everett M. Rogers. They talked about a technology adoption life cycle and developed a model that explained how in order to get to market saturation, there were five waves of technology adopters: the innovators, the early adopters, the early majority, the late majority, and then the laggards. Right now, laggards would be customers that are still running Exchange 2003, Windows XP on the desktops. You kind of get the idea from a Microsoft perspective as to where that is. Innovators tend to be people who want technologies just because it's brand new and it's shiny. Then you've got the early adopters who see business benefit and the early majority. The reason why I'm kind of highlighting this is when we look at the sales statistics for Office 365, you know, across the world, but also very specifically in the UK, we honestly believe we are beyond the early adopter stage now in relation to Office 365 sales. So, you know, I've got some kind of figures that show where we are in relation to market share, and also in relation to where we expect to be in 12 months' time. From a Microsoft kind of licensing revenue and sales perspective, the growth over the next 12 months is going to be phenomenal. So, you know, we plan on kind of doing more in the next 12 months than we have to date since the launch of BPOS. If that gives you some kind of idea of kind of the growth and the size, that then great. If you need more specific details, please reach out to us after the meeting, and we'll share what we can there. There are key drivers that we think are going to enable this, and one of those is around the end of support for Windows XP. And obviously, extended support lifecycle ending for lots of products across what were released in 2003, so Exchange 2003, Office 2003. Once those products go out of support, you know, there's much more of a need for a customer to migrate off there. And when we look at kind of products such as Small Business Server 2003 as well, you can see that there's a whole market of laggards out there just waiting to try and not spend a big capital expenditure budget on IT upgrade, because all they've done is pursue its cost over time. And I think that's one of the key things about trying to sell cloud, whether that's public cloud from an Office 365 perspective, whether it's private cloud from a in a data center hosted perspective, and it's the ability to take the initial capital expenditure for new server, new hardware, new kit, and actually move that to an operational expenditure model. Seen some real good success out there now with resellers who are going to market with a kind of an extend the life of your existing server campaign. So where the Exchange server is on a, say, a Small Business server, and there's a very big email load on there, it's a case of, Mr. Customer, do you know that your server is going to be due for replacement? You may get a lot more life out of that if you think about taking the email off and moving it to a hosted platform right now, and then presenting kind of options to the customer in turn. So, you know, definitely opportunity out there. And what I'm kind of touching on there is the Microsoft Productivity Vision, which is key to Microsoft Office, but also the services in the back end. I said at the start that, you know, there is no way that I would go out to an audience and say that Office 365 is right for every customer in every scenario. The Microsoft strategy in relation to this is that the customer should be able to have cloud-based services on their terms. You know, it's their choice, it's their business, they get to choose the platform that it runs on, whether that's on premises in a very traditional way, whether that's online in a public data center, or whether that's hosted in a private data center, or whether it's a hybrid, and it's a combination of all of those factors. Really, from a kind of vendor in the industry perspective, we've got an excellent story around management of all three types: on-premise, hosted, private data center. You know, public virtualized, private virtualized. We've got a fantastic kind of story around how you can deploy to each and any, and basically ensure that as a customer you can take, you know, for example, Exchange online within data center, yet still keep Office on-premise and kind of harness local processing power of machines and devices from an end user point of view. All of the things and all of the trends that are coming down around consumerization IT, and how kind of You know, the emerging workforce is now much more familiar about using voice and video to present, to have conference calls, to manage content, to deliver instant messaging and presence. All of those things require kind of modern devices and modern software. The services at the back end, generally as an end user, you care very little as to where your Exchange server lives, as long as you can get your email. And that's kind of one of the key things that you know, we need to consider when positioning cloud services. So in relation to the Microsoft data centers that basically provision these services, we have many around the world. We've got twin pairs in Asia Pacific. We've got quite a few around North America, a couple of twin pairs and one major failover. Within Europe, or actually within EMEA, we have two data centers. One is in Dublin, primary data center. The other is in Amsterdam, failover data center. What I'd say is that if you want to know more about them, go to the Global Foundation Services website. I believe it's globalfoundationservices.com. We can get you the link after if you need it. If you do want to know a lot more about the Microsoft data centers, that's the best place to start. There's lots of things on there around certifications and accreditations, ISO 27001, you know, SAS 70 and various things for the North American ones. All of the things that you will need to know about the Microsoft data centers are going to be in there. Suffice to say that, you know, there is no data center within the UK or within England. And hopefully, you know, as a hosting provider, you understand that one of your key value selling points is around the fact that you can guarantee, you know, UK-based or English-based data center for customer data. When you come to some of the kind of regulations, data protection, data privacy, we as Microsoft have a very good story and a very strong story around that, particularly in relation to EU Safe Harbor Agreement, and the fact that we do not own the customer data. So, you know, if you want to, you know, if we get a government legal demand for data, we do everything we can. There's a really good blog post from Brad Smith, the head of legal and corporate affairs at Microsoft, to redirect the government to the customer. And then basically, you know, the customer owns the data, we don't own the data. So that article's also worth a read around information privacy and security, I'd suggest. So highly efficient, highly environmentally sustainable data centers. And one of the things that we provision for them is Office 365. Not only that, but also Windows Azure, SQL Azure, consumer services, Xbox Live, Hotmail, all of the things that live in different server racks in our data centers exist within Dublin and Amsterdam. We do have additional data centers around EMEA for content delivery network purposes. It's an absolute guarantee that one of the, you know, a copy of the data will be in both of those data centers. Looking at the SKU availability there, the reason why I thought it wise to talk about this today as well is very much around the fact that if we go back to before February 2013, the only way in which you could acquire Office 365 as a customer was from, you'd got a syndication model and you'd got enterprise agreement, but outside of that, it was direct from Microsoft. Direct from Microsoft on the potentially with a partner of record attached, which meant that Microsoft owned the billing relationship, and we paid rebates to partners or resellers based on partner of record. Since February, we made Office 365 midsize available through open licensing. So that's basically the way in which SMB customers have always procured Office licensing. It's been through a reseller via distribution in the UK. So what this meant was that, you know, a reseller could then take Office 365, buy it through distribution in the usual manner, add margin, and sell on to the customer. So that was available in February. The as of September 2013, we added multiple SKUs to the open-based licensing. So you can now buy Exchange online through open licensing. You can buy Enterprise E1 and Enterprise E3 Office 365 all through open licensing. You can also buy the academic SKUs. So when I talk about E1 and E3, there are corresponding academic SKUs, A1 and A3. You can also acquire them through open-based licensing. So the other thing is that the small business premium, just like home premium, that's sold through retail and that's done via FPP. So for the smallest of the small customers, remember I said that capped out at 25 users per domain. Generally, it's designed for 1 to 10 users because you've got to migrate. If you ever go beyond 25, you really have it at the hard cap limit and you would have to migrate back off the cloud to get onto another platform. So just to be aware of that from an FPP perspective, very much a retail play. Those SKUs now being available through open licensing, and that's another one of the reasons why we think we're set for a 12 months kind of pretty significant growth. Now that commercial resellers, transactional resellers, and services-based resellers who are, you know, used to managing on-premise products, not just or maybe don't have hosted capabilities right now, they can also start to transition their customer base to a public cloud, or work in conjunction with hosting partners to build out their strategy. So hopefully that's kind of helped understand what Office is and what the opportunity is in relation to Office 365. I think just before I go on to the objection handling, I should be completely honest with you. And when I talk to resellers, generally, you know, the one thing I will say is that no customer is likely to go all in to the cloud or all into the public cloud. And I think the message that really we're taking out there is that if you talk to your customers about online services or cloud-based computing, there really should be three angles to your kind of market proposition. One of those is public cloud and, you know, vanilla-based services, Exchange Online, Microsoft Data Center potentially, where it's public cloud and, you know, it is what it is. You know, you're not going to be able to write any custom code and put that up into the Microsoft Office 365 data center. So if you need heavy customization in relation to SharePoint, probably not the best place to put that is Office 365. So beyond the kind of public vanilla cloud, you need to have another level, and that's around hosting, private hosting. So when I talk to our resale community rather than our hosters, I say, you know, consider partnering with a hosting provider right now, because they have an opportunity that you don't as a reseller if you solely go with your traditional on-premise and public cloud option. So I think there's definitely opportunity there in the marketplace around kind of strategic partnerships. But the three steps to the strategy is public cloud, if that doesn't suit the customer needs, private or hosted cloud, if that doesn't suit the customer needs, traditional on-premise. And it's very much that kind of three-step scenario to how to kind of wrap a market proposition together from a reseller perspective. So just I quickly cover off some of these objections. I hear this all the time now. Why should I care about selling Office 365 via open FPP? There's actually really decent margin to be made if you compare. If you go to your preferred distribution partner, so either Ingram Micro, Computer 2000, West Coast, or Avnet from an open licensing perspective in the UK, and ask for the cost price around Microsoft Office 365, you will find out quite quickly that there is, I think of this in the same way as I think about my car insurance. I buy annually so that I don't have to pay a monthly premium. And I get a really, really, I get a reasonable discount for paying annually upfront. Given open licensing is annually upfront, that's the kind of discount that you can acquire, save on cost of license, and pass on to your customers as you choose to, in relation to what the Microsoft Direct Publish price is. So that's the kind of the starting point there about why potentially as a salesperson you should consider it, and not just buy it direct from Microsoft. There are margins to be made, and it is an effective way to now acquire and provision kind of Office 365 for a customer. I think the other thing I get quite a lot of is, can I deploy Office 365 within a UK data center? And the answer is no. You know, it's just not possible. We've got twin pair data centers in EMEA, Dublin and Amsterdam. And if you do have a need, so I mean, the one example that I always give is around patient information data in the NHS. You know, that doesn't just have to be in a UK data center. There's things written into the data privacy needs there that say if it's in England, it has to reside in a data center in England. So it even goes to that specific level. Know that Microsoft has European data centers, and if that's fine for most commercial organizations, then great, look to use our service. Otherwise, think about the next level of needs that you have and how that fits in with regards to what you want to do with your kind of exchange or email strategy. From a customer perspective, obviously, whether that's going to be kept on-premise or hosted. One of the questions I also get is whether or not you can deploy via remote desktop services or VDI, and the answer is yes. So when I talked about those five devices, if you are going to deploy via RDS, and that RDS is on-premise, obviously, just be clear about that, one of the five instances for one of the five Office instances within RDS can be used, so everybody kind of gets an RDS deployment plus the ability to install on up to four other devices. You do have to get hold of volume license media. You have to apply for an exception to that because of the heartbeat and the way it gets validated. Click to run deployment doesn't work with RDS. So that's one thing. Probably one of the things I didn't cover was click to run deployment for Office to the desktop earlier. It's very much pull from the Microsoft data centers across the small business, premium and mid-sized business range. So if you think about, one of the traditional headaches for an IT kind of department has been patching, managing, maintaining not only servers but also desktops. And if you think about the fact that, you know, let's say you were to install Office 2010 on a machine, 12 months ago, you'd put Office 2010 on, then you'd have the update, Service Pack 1, Service Pack 2. The click to run deployment for Office 365, the always up to date piece, streams it direct from our data center, so it always streams the latest up to date version. There's no need to patch or manage. It's always up to date on point of install. It kind of installs silently, installs updates silently in the background, incremental updates, and so on and so forth. That's great. That's streamed via kind of an application virtualization capability from a Microsoft data center. When you get into larger customers, they tend to want to customize their Office deployments. Only the enterprise family of products allow you to customize Office deployment by way of, removal of products or, various things using XML configuration files that say this is how I want to deploy Office 365 within my organization in regards to Office on the desktops. So with the enterprise family plan of products, you can do a pull from the internet, set up one kind of deployment server internally, and then customize how Office 365 gets pushed out to desktops from there. It's not as flexible as MSI, I'm going to be completely honest, but there are options available. Lots of detail about that on TechNet if you needed to dig into it further. Does Office 365 come with downgrade rights? That's one of the other things that I guessed, and the answer is no. Office 365 is an always up-to-date license, and then somebody comes along and says, well, what do I do about my accounting package? I'm running this accounting package, and that needs Excel 2007 to integrate. Say, well, if you've got a copy of Excel 2007, because Office 365, Office on the desktop, is deployed via click to run, it's completely sandboxed. It will happily coexist with that version of Excel 2007. In fact, it will happily coexist with Office 2010 and Office 2007, any version, any application. It's not supported to be deployed in side by side with Office 2003. So I'm not saying it doesn't work. I've never tested it. I just know for a fact that it's not supported and it's not a recommended configuration. Can I install Office 365 on Windows XP? That's a really quick one. No. It won't install, and it'll tell you it's not even going to try and install. So if you're still running XP, end of life, April the 8th, 2014, time to get off and move to a modern kind of operating system from a desktop perspective. And this is really interesting from a technical standpoint. I use this as my technical Bible, because these services within the data centers, Exchange Online, SharePoint Online, they are constantly evolving and it's always up to date, and we're constantly adding little bits of new features, little bits of new functionality. So when a customer or, you know, a reseller comes to me and says, my customer is asking me, is this included in Office 365? Chances are, if I haven't checked that recently, my answer might be out of date. That's probably over-egging it a little bit, because, you know, once something's in there, it's unlikely that we'll take it out. But there are certain things that I know aren't contained that are scheduled for integration. If you go to 0365SD.com or Office365ServiceDescriptions.com, line by line, SKU by SKU, you have a yes, no, yes, no across Exchange, SharePoint, Office Pro Plus, Link, and whether this is included. Is it in Small Business Premium? Is it in Midsize? Is it in Online Plan 1, Plan 2, etc.? That is a fantastic resource. So that's 0365SD.com. Head on over there if you want to know lots of sort of technical goodness about what's what in Office 365. So I'm just kind of going to wrap up and we'll head to Q&A in a moment, but every time there's a release of Office, it brings about new opportunities. My message to kind of customers and resellers here is it's always been consistent. It's, you know, if I'm waving bye-bye to my trusty old Mazda that I've been driving for quite some time, that's got me to A to B, you know, very happily for kind of the past 5, 6, 7 years, and I invest in a brand new Ferrari, kind of I wish. But if I drive that Ferrari in exactly the same way as I drive the Mazda, you know, I'm not going to get any benefit out of it whatsoever. I will still get from A to B in exactly the same time as I always have. Might look a little bit different, might be a little bit flashier, you know, but it's not going to change the way I work. So, you know, with a release of Office and with a deployment of Office, or with a deployment of kind of modern hosted email services or a SharePoint flat platform, comes an opportunity for every business to kind of re-engineer certain business processes and to think about why they do things in a certain way and how they can make, you know, a better use out of the technology that they're going to make an investment in moving forwards. I've seen many a customer at many events saying, oh, we've just replaced our small business server with another server, another small business server from an OEM stock perspective. And they've gone into the conversation, or they've gone into the sort of, we need an upgrade, without thinking about why, other than the fact that the old server needs replacing. And that to me seems like a very strange conversation for a customer to have with a reseller. And I think that whereas a kind of hosting provider, you're in a much stronger place from a traditional reseller perspective, in that you understand the options and you understand that, you know, from a business perspective, it's not just about replacing like with like. The flexibility in the platforms are out there right now, and if a customer wants to do something slightly differently, you know, in relation to kind of traditional resellers and how they've gone about keeping the lights running over time, I think you're in a very strong place to kind of steal a march, whether you position your own hosted platform, whether you position the Microsoft hosted platform, or whether you position a combination or a choice of to each and every customer. I think that's key to it, because worst case scenario says now we'll just stick with what we've already been doing and stick with on-premise. So, you know, I think that's the way I position it. And I think there's an opportunity right now to kind of think about how you can extend on consulting services in regards to the cloud opportunity, and what that means with a desktop refresh or a move to a modern desktop and a modern hosted platform for customers. So, you know, get good at giving the pitch, get good at the consulting angle, talk your customers through, understand some of the common objections and understand what the right thing might be for your customers based on their needs. Pretty sure you would be, you know, very, very nicely positioned to have the right conversation with your customers and help steer them down to the correct future platform of choice for their needs. So with that, I'm going to say thanks for your time. Thanks for listening in. We're going to move to some Q&A very shortly. I hope that was worthwhile. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Chris. It's Mark back here again. So appreciate you running through that so quickly. Obviously, a lot of material to go through there. I'm actually just going to stop the recording now before we enter into the Q&A session.